Hi, I'm Adriene Hill.
And I'm Jacob Clifford, and welcome to Crash Course Economics.
So far, we've talked about GDP and how we measure the overall economy, but we haven't really talked about why some countries have a high GDP and others have a low GDP. So why are some countries rich and others poor? Let's investigate.
Look, a clue. Productivity.
So if we're gonna figure out why some countries are rich and some are poor, we have to first define what it means to be rich. Economists measure economic output by looking at gross domestic product, or GDP. As you remember from the last video, GDP is the market value of all goods and services newly produced in a country in 1 year. India's GDP is over 6 times larger than the GDP of Singapore. But that doesn't mean the average Indian is richer than the average Singaporean. That's because India has 240 times more people than Singapore. So economists look at something called GDP per capita to determine how wealthy a country is. GDP per capita is the GDP of the country divided by its population. It represents output per person, and a country with a high GDP per capita is considered rich. Of course, some of you might say, being rich has nothing to do with GDP or money. It has to do with whether or not you're happy. Well, fine. Money may not buy happiness, but it can prevent a lot of misery. The United Nations Human Development Index, or HDI, measures life expectancy, literacy, education, and quality of life, and it ranks countries according to their findings. The data shows that countries that have a high GDP per capita have far less infant mortality, poverty, and preventable diseases. So economists often use GDP per capita to measure a country's standard of living. Countries with a low standard of living are the ones that are conventionally considered poor. So why are some countries poor?
If you ask someone on the street, they might say the difference is due to lack of natural resources or inept governments. That is, if the person doesn't subscribe to some antiquated racial or social Darwinist stereotypes. But we should talk about those ideas. Well, let's skip the racial and social Darwinist stereotypes, but resources and leadership are interesting. First, resources. Look at Singapore, 3rd in GDP per capita and 9th on the Human Development Index. Or Switzerland, 9th in GDP per capita and 3rd on the HDI. Singapore is a teeny tiny island. And Switzerland's main natural resources is cows. And cows are great. I love cows. Love. But they aren't really natural resources. Zimbabwe, on the other hand, has tons of natural resources, like fertile soil, coal, and rare minerals. But their economy, it's a wreck. It's 161st in GDP per capita and 156th on the HDI. Their incompetent and corrupt government keeps them poor. For comparison's sake, the GDP per capita in the US is 18 times higher than in Bangladesh. And we're not just trouncing Bangladesh. GDP per capita-wise, we're also crushing the GDP numbers of our great-grandparents. Take that, Aloysius. GDP per capita in the US today is about 8 times higher than 100 years ago. That's pretty impressive. Maybe the thought bubble can produce an explanation.
Let's say John runs a bakery. Each worker can produce a dozen donuts per hour, and each donut sells for $1. If John wants to stay in business, he can't pay his workers more than $12 an hour. Obviously, he needs to pay for the ingredients and the oven, but even if he wanted to be generous, he couldn't pay them like $20 an hour. They just don't produce enough donuts to cover the cost. But if John could find a way for each worker to produce 4 dozen donuts per hour, he could pay them $20 per hour. Simply put, the more that each worker can produce, the more money each can earn. Economists argue the main reason some countries are rich is because of their productivity, their ability to produce more output per worker per hour. US workers altogether earn 18 times more per hour than Bangladeshi workers because they're able to produce 18 times more output per hour. US workers today earn 8 times more per hour than US workers 100 years ago because they produce 8 times more output per hour. But not only is the US producing more stuff, it's also producing higher value products, like Avengers movies and jet engines. So going back to our bakery example, it's like a worker from 100 years ago being able to produce 6 plain donuts per hour, while a worker today is able to produce 60 salted caramel designer cupcakes per hour.
Thanks, Thought Bubble. Before we go further, we need to point out the limitations of this bakery example. It's true, productivity is key. A country that is more productive can create more stuff and can generate higher incomes. But in real life, it doesn't always look like that. For example, in the US, the GDP per capita has been steadily increasing for decades, but median family incomes haven't changed much at all. This gets to issues of income inequality, and we're going to devote an entire episode to it. Limitations aside, low productivity remains a fundamental reason why some countries are poor. Higher productivity not only helps explain why we have more money to buy stuff, but also why we have more stuff to buy. And speaking of stuff to buy, because it is socially unacceptable somehow for me to appear in the same clothes over and over, I need 40 blouses to make this series. That is a lot of blouses. That strains resources, pollutes the planet, and at high levels like 40 is completely unsustainable. Don't worry though, some of these are from thrift stores. So what about people in poor countries? What do they need? They need food, clothing, and housing. They need clean water and plumbing and sewers. They need hospitals and medicine. But all those things have to be produced. So a country that produces more of these things with fewer resources is going to be wealthier and healthier and perhaps even happier than a country that can't. But making a million cell phones isn't very impressive if your country has 100 million people. So we need to look at how much stuff we produce per person. That's GDP per capita.
So if everything all boils down to productivity, what makes some countries more productive than others? Well, let's go back and look at the main ingredients that we need to produce things, or what economists call the factors of production. First, you need land, which includes all natural resources, and then you need workers, which is labor. Then you need capital, which includes machines and factories and infrastructure, things you need to produce other things. One special type of capital is the workers' education, knowledge, and skills required to produce things. Economists call this human capital. So school's not just about torching you, except for PE, it's about developing your human capital. The quantity and quality of these resources is the first step to being more productive. But perhaps even more important is how you use them. Increasing the amount of capital has a cost, but finding new ways to organize production is virtually free. Economists call the organizational effectiveness technology. Think of it as the good ideas about how to combine labor and capital that you already have. U.S. workers produce so much more than Bangladeshi workers because the U.S. has more factories, robots, and computers. But more capital only gets you so far. It increases your production capacity, but it also eats up some of that production capacity. You have to develop more factories and workers and machines to make more capital, and then replace them when they wear out. Technology, on the other hand, takes the same amount of resources and organizes them in a way to produce more output.
Here's an example. 25 years ago, you could find computers in just about every workplace in the US, but productivity growth in the US was flat. Then, starting in about 1995, US productivity boomed, led by computer technology. So what changed? In the late 80s and early 90s, most workplace computers were individual units, plugged into nothing but an electric outlet. They were useful for writing and printing documents, or acting as overgrown calculators and playing Oregon Trail. But that was about it. When the World Wide Web came along, everything changed. It turns out that computers are far more useful when they can talk to each other. The computer at the store could talk to the computer at the warehouse, which could talk to the computer at the factory. That means I can get a new blouse from the other side of the world pretty much immediately. Connectivity equals productivity. Productivity in the US boomed for the next 10 years, and wages jumped as a result. 200 years ago, productivity in the US wasn't that great, but it grew a little bit every year. Compounding that over decades and centuries gives us the huge gap between the US standard of living and that of many developing countries. The good news is that in recent decades, many developing countries like China, South Korea, Mexico, and Ghana have dramatically improved their capital and technology and have seen their living standards rise. So if you want a single one-word answer as to why some countries are more successful than others, here it is. Productivity. So if you look at the big picture,
and by big picture we mean both globally and historically,
increasing productivity has resulted in increased standards of living for much of humanity over the last 100 years, and it's hard to argue that this is a bad thing.
Thanks for watching. We'll see you next week. Thanks for watching Crash Course Economics. It was made with the help of all these nice people. You can improve their standard of living by supporting Crash Course at Patreon. It's a voluntary subscription platform that allows you to pay whatever you want monthly to help make Crash Course free for everyone, forever. Thanks for watching the FTBA.